All right, it's 7 PM, so we'll call the meeting to order. Christine, can we have the roll call, please?
David Hosmer.
Excused.
Ron Cabana.
Here.
Frederick Shamura.
Here.
Michael Bowery.
Here.
Glenn Lessig.
Here.
David Fortin.
Here.
David Richardson.
Here.
Roy Brydrick.
He's excused due to illness.
And Jesse Keller.
Here. Thank you. All right, the next order of business is to seat an alternate.
I'll move to seat Dave Richardson.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second to seat Mr. Richardson. Any discussion on that? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. All right, so the reason why we're here tonight is to have a discussion on the upcoming budget. And first thing, item A would be the allocation of available funds. So we need to, first off, agree to the fact of what funds are available. We've all received a copy of the attorney's opinion on the Prop 46 calculation, which agrees with what came out of the treasurer's office, and that's $330,261. There is also an additional amount, because Proposition 46 does not address decreases in the budget, only increases. So based on the reduction of our debt service, there's an additional $70,495, which gives us a grand total that the maximum this budget can increase is $400,756.
Could you repeat that figure again?
It's 330-261.
Yep.
Is the Prop 46 calculation. Mm-hmm. And then within the budget, there is an additional in this.
This is ours.
There's an additional $70,495, okay, which comes up to a total to be allocated of $400,756.
Okay, thank you.
Excuse me, Mike, but that's yes, a little bit misleading. It's misleading in the sense that it doesn't mean there's $70,000 of extra money. I mean, if you look at the total spending budget that's allowed, is exactly as Karen put in the Prop 46 worksheet, which is $22,674,814.
That's correct.
Oh, okay, so
yeah,
that's how much the maximum spending is.
Correct.
The reduction in the debt service only means that that's money that was being spent one way that can now be spent.
Can now be spent another way, correct.
Okay, just want to. No, that's not $70,000 more money.
Correct. No, that's true. It's just, it was spent previously. It'll be more than likely spent another way in the future. All right, so right now, I'm getting the general opinion and the sense that the people are asking us to go to the maximum of Prop 46, which would be, as Dave just mentioned, $22,674,814. So I'm thinking what we need to do first is come up with a plan if in fact that's where we go, and then beyond that, explore our other options, meaning reductions below the Prop 46 level, or whatever ideas everyone might have. And that being the case, my proposal would be to give the town what in fact they had asked for, which was
$623,623.
Okay. And that would leave out of that expendable amount, the $400,756, that would leave $374,197, which we could in turn allocate to the Board of Education.
Could I back you up here from the...
Yes.
Let's take the subtotal of the maximum allowed on Prop 46, of $22,674,814, and subtract from that the proposed Board of Selectmen budget of $5,005,623.
Yep.
That'd give us $17,669,191, and then subtract the cost of redemption of debt. That would leave an amount equal to...
$17,72,923.
Yep, that's correct. That could be allocated to the Board of Ed if we so chose.
What was that number again?
$17,282,923.
Now, just to speak about that for a minute, based on last year's Board of Education budget, that would be an increase of $374,197, which would be 113% of the total increase allowed under Prop 46. That's greater than the amount that would be allowed under Prop 46, according to my calculation.
It's only because of the $43,000 that's left.
Yes.
For the debt on the town side.
Right. Okay. That's correct. The town side budget left. Yes, that's correct. That's where you're rolling this whole thing.
Yes. So, as I said, that's just to start with, we have to look at, if we go to the maximum of Prop 46, we have to have our ducks in a row here as to where we're going. We have to give them some numbers to shoot for, and like I say, we can discuss other options, lower amounts, but I think we need to get that out of the way first, because the biggest problem you're going to have is if the people are requesting Prop 46 max, we don't put that forward for vote and it's turned down, we don't know which way to go.
Well, if only one way you can go.
That is not true.
Well, you could shift money from the Board of Ed to the town.
No. If we don't go to the limit.
Oh, if we don't go to the
limit. If we don't go to the limit, we don't know what they mean when they vote. It could be they think it's too high, or it could be they think it's too low. So my opinion, and I have to agree with most of the people that spoke the other night, and I'm sure there'll be more at the public hearing, that the taxpayers are the ones that are spending the money, and they should have the right to decide. And if that's what's available, we should give them the opportunity to choose that. If they vote it down, then there is, in fact, only one way to go, and that's down. And that's what we have to look at for other additional options as where we would go if they voted it down at the maximum allowable. So that's my opinion, and now...
I think there's a much bigger issue out there than any of what we've just been talking about. I mean, because I have no doubt that we're going to go to the limit of Prop 46, since we do that every year. The only year we didn't do it was last year. And that's in the last 4 or 5 years. The bigger issue that's hanging out there is that assume that the state does away with the pensions issue, $683,000. We have a shortfall. If you look at the revenues versus the number that we've got out there, $22,674,194,000, which would, if the budget passed at the limit, have to be made up. It can be made up by pulling it out of the general fund, or it would be made up in a tax increase. That's about 0.28 mils. And that starts with a 4% tax increase, because that's what's on the revenue page. The revenue page has 4% tax increase.
Mr. Richardson, I'm sorry to interrupt.
I'm sorry.
It was my understanding that we were going to deal with this first scenario and then talk about what you talk about the pension possibility and how we would handle that if that comes to pass.
All I'm trying to do, Glenn, is the decision is whether you're going to go to the limit of Prop 46. Mike's argument is the same argument as every year, which is let the people decide. And if we go to the maximum, then, and they turn it down, there's only one direction it can go. So what I'm trying to do is put the other context into that, and that it, and the people have to know this before they vote on it, is there's $194,000 that has to be made up from someplace if the pension thing goes away. And if it doesn't go away as a pension thing and come back as $200,000 or $400,000 or something now,
position,
we have no idea. And the reality is, between now and the 18th of April, there's zero chance that we're going to know that. Between now and the time of the referendum, there's ever so slightly more than zero chance that we're going to know. So there's going to be a whole lot of going blind here. And then what happens, happens. So what I'm trying to get across here is we've got a couple $100,000 shortfall under what's likely to be the best of scenarios. If the teacher's pension thing hangs in there, you simply add $863,000 to it. Now, if it's only 200 grand, you take it out of the general fund, the taxpayers get a 4% tax increase, and then next year, we start out $600,000 in the hole. Because don't forget, the reason why we even got here is the $393,000 in the over and under. That's carrying forward to next year. That, in theory, doesn't exist next year. So, whatever we take out of the general fund, add 400,000 to it, that's where we start from for next year, for zero. So I'm just trying to get elephant versus woodchuck kind of problem here. And if this, you know, we're not gonna know whether it's an elephant till the state tells us.
Well, let's have the plan elephant ready to go. And let's just deal with what we know right now. You know, just to get started,
right.
And then I think we need to have that conversation about what happens if things go really bad. What are we going to do? What's our best guess of how we can handle it? Have that discussion and be prepared. But I agree with what you're saying, Mike. I think we owe it to the tax, to the residents of town, to go to the maximum, let them vote on it, let them tell us, and what you're saying makes perfect sense. We know then we'll have to go down. It's the only thing we can do anyway. We can't go back up.
Right.
So it makes sense to go to that level to start with.
So tonight we're only here to give the Board of Ed and the Board of Selectmen our consensus,
yeah.
Suggestion of where they got to come in at the public hearing.
Correct.
And the public hearing isn't going to be till what, the 18th?
18th.
No, the public hearing's on the 4th. The 18th is your final budget. So
thank you.
Yeah, it's next week is the public hearing.
Okay, fine. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So the first part of it, I think, you know, taking into account what Dave said and what Glenn and Mike have said, is to decide if we think that putting the teacher's pension issue aside for a moment, if this is what we want, what we would like to work towards. And that's what's going to say. If we agree on that, then the second part of the conversation is what if. So I think we should do this thing in two steps.
Yeah, well, that was the whole idea, to allocate the available funds.
As we understand them.
As we understand them now, as they stand. And then, look at, the next part would be funding options based on, you know, what ifs, so that we have a fallback plan. Jeff, you got anything you want to add?
I would support the real proposal. At the last meeting, the overwhelming consensus from the taxpayers and voters, that we try for a max and see where we go from there. And, you know, there certainly are some other discussions regarding the teacher's pension fund, but if we're not dealing with that at this moment, then I would just say let's go to the max right now.
Right now, we really can't.
Right.
There's several ways to look at it. One is, they're saying it's dead on arrival. I don't believe that to be true. I think what's going to happen is going to get their foot in the door with an amount, regardless of how small it is. It might only be 5%, but they're going to get their foot in the door, much like they did with the state income tax that was supposed to be temporary. And we're all still living with it now, and then it will only do, much like the income tax, increase over time. So I think it's something that we have to be prepared for. And from the people that I've spoken with, there's going to have to be some give and take on their end, and you could be looking at the difference of 1/6 to 1/3 of what was originally proposed. So you're looking at somewhere, rough numbers, $150,000 to $300,000 is a possibility that they're going to look for.
So let's go back to my suggestion would be, let's go back to our two-step approach here. Let's start with your original proposal that you made, and discuss that and decide if we agree that the consensus is that's the direction you want to go in. Then we'll go back and work on that other component. Ron?
Personally, I don't think the state is going to push this pension fund. Everything I hear and read about it is positive for us. And I think we need to move forward. I don't want to say ignore it, because I think what you say about it is there is a possibility they may go for a smaller percentage of it, but I certainly don't want to see the town put in a position where we have to send out supplemental bills. But let's see what the state says.
Fred?
Giving my comments to the issue in front of us first, I agree that I think we should go to the maximum Prop 46 and bring that to public hearing next week.
I also agree with that, taking it to the max.
I'm comfortable with the mill rate increase of 0.28 is what I've calculated at the increase in the Prop 46 budget. I don't want it to get tangled up in the impact of the revaluation. That's certainly going to impact each one of us differently. Revaluation provides value to each taxpayer, and in many cases, such as my own, it's of my own doing. I've done improvements, my property's gone up in value. There's nobody in the room that doesn't want their property to go up in value. I do understand that that total equates to about 0.9 mils on average. Some people will be zero, less, or greater than. I don't want to get that tangled up in this discussion. We may end up there. So I'm going to just talk about the overall mill rate increase at 0.28. I think is very reasonable shortfall to the Board of Education budget this year, so I would support it at the maximum number at this point with the information I have today.
Anyone else? Well, do you want to make a motion that we direct the boards of Ed and Selectmen to bring their budgets to those numbers?
My recommendation, I would make the motion that the Board of Selectmen bring their budget to $5,005,623 as proposed. That the Board of Education brings their budget to $17,282,923.
And the redemption of debt will remain at $386,268 for a total of $22,674,814, correct?
What was the debt?
Yes.
$386,268.
Yes, I accept that friendly amendment. That is correct.
I'll second that.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
I think we've got the cart rolling in front of the horse here, in the sense that we have a meeting on the 18th of April to set the final budget.
That's correct.
This is a recommendation.
But this is a recommendation to go.
To bring back a budget.
To bring back for the public hearing. After that, we will meet again and decide on the final budget.
Well, I think in terms of the Board of Ed, you know, going to the limit of Prop 46, I think they've already pretty much got that outlined in their last proposal.
And that's fine.
So they basically don't have to change anything from what was proposed. I mean, for them to go through the whole thing to add $43,000, which is what it amounts to, would be a ridiculous amount of work. I mean, on the 18th of April, then it'll be the final.
That's correct.
The only one other thing, comment I'll make as we're doing this is the town budget at $5,005,623, or whatever it is, that's actually over a 7% growth from last year's actual expended budget. In that package we got on the budget, there was a column labeled expended 15-16. There was a little note up at the top before the audit. The $4,888,160 that was, quote, expended that year for the town government didn't count for $225,000 of surplus that was in that budget. So it was actually much less than that. The $4,888,160 was the budget, not the expenditure. So what we've got is a compound growth rate on the town government side of 3.6% per year. That's pretty significant. That's not an insignificant growth rate in today's terms. And I'm just saying that so it's on the record.
Okay, I just want to understand that a little bit differently, because I have the actual budget from fiscal year ending June 30th of 2016. And the surplus as of June 30th was $225,601.02. We always back out the contingency because that stays in the general fund. So the amount that was actually considered a surplus to move forward was the $194,601.02. We bring that to your attention at the transfer meeting in September. We give you a list of recommendations which you all have approved. So that expended column that says before audit does contain exactly what that budget is to come to that amount. So I don't understand.
It contains the budgeted amount. What was actually expended was the $4,888,160 less the $225,000 surplus.
But in that expended column is the expended, the actual, and the transferred amount in there.
Yes, I know. what was actually spent in the year 15-16 was $4,888,160 less $220,000, which was used as a transfer to other accounts post-July 1st.
If our budget was $5,386,288, and at the end of the year we turned back $194,601,202, how are you saying that we spent less?
Let me see.
I guess I don't understand your.
You actually spent the town budget. The town actually spent $4,662,559. $225,000 was turned back.
Right.
It either ended up being transferred to an account to be used in 2017, road uses, one that comes to mind, $52,000.
Well, it's still transferred in the same fiscal year in CNR.
It's transferred, but it's not spent.
No, it's not
spent. It's not spent.
But it is in that column.
It's in that column, but it's not, it wasn't spent.
It wasn't actually spent, no, but it will be spent by the town.
It will be spent eventually. Eventually it will get spent. $119,000 got transferred into either the general fund.
$194,000.
Yes, but some of that ended up going.
Well, I don't know.
$52,000 went into road use.
$119,000
went into either the CNR account or the general fund. That's where it went. It wasn't spent in 2015-16. What was spent was $4,662,559. Spent.
Is this the same accounting procedures that we use every year?
Yep.
I mean, did this change this year?
Here's what was on here. We asked last year to have the actual expenditure so that the idea, Glenn, being how much did you actually spend in a year to how much are you budgeting in the new year? What I'm pointing out is if you take $5,005,623 divided by $4,662,559, you're going to get 1.073, which means the budget that's being proposed in 2018 is 7.3% higher than what was actually spent in 2015-16.
But it could very easily be that at the end of the year we may have a similar excess that gets transferred at the end of the correct. At the end of
that
the
is
year.
Correct. Yes.
And, I mean, have we been doing the same thing every year where at the end we have a couple hundred thousand dollars that we move around?
Normally, we have for the last couple of years. What I'm pointing out, Glenn, is
we are planning
a budget that has an increase of 7.3% over last year. That's a lot.
Mr. Ford?
Well, I think what Dave's talking about is general operating costs, and perhaps what we're thinking about, maybe Glenn, you correct me if I'm wrong, is the overall budget. I mean, these unexpended funds that get transferred, whether it be into the capital non-reoccurring or into the general fund, which is what built the general fund, and what built the capital non-reoccurring capital fund, is what we use to pay things like Butts Road Bridge, right, John? Mm-hmm. I mean, so you could also make the argument that those monies are budgeted and were created as a savings account to use them. Personally, I'd like to start using them rather than accumulating large, huge sums, whether it be for air conditioning in the third floor at school, the Butts Road Bridge, Lebanon Hill Road, what it might be. So I don't disagree with you, Dave, as far as it's the operating fund, the actual operating expenses increasing at a certain rate. But we have to decide whether it's the operating expenses plus our savings towards the items that we've decided that we're going to do. Just like you do it, just like you do in your home. You know, I put money in savings, I put money towards accounts that I'm gonna do central air in my house, or what it might be. I know that's a very simplistic analogy, but I think that's what we're looking at here. Now, I'm
so
not gonna-
let's just say that what we're doing is really budgeting an operating budget, plus we're throwing a couple $100,000 in there that
for our
we don't wanna talk about.
No, that's things that
that's,
we don't wanna
That's for the capital improvement program. Capital. That's why you have a 5-year capital improvement program for things that, that you want to do that you normally couldn't afford to do, and this is why these funds are set aside. When there are extra funds, they're set aside to go there.
That's not what's in here.
I didn't get it.
That's not what's in here, and that's not what people are being told when they pick this up.
Anyone else?
Call a motion.
What's that?
Call
He's motion. Asking to call a motion. All right, call the motion. We have a motion on the floor to make a recommendation.
Make a recommendation that the Board of Education comes back with a budget not to exceed $17,282,923. The town comes in with a general government operating budget of $5,005,623. And $386,268 be set aside for redemption of debt, for a grand total of $22,674,814. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Nay.
Anybody abstain?
All right.
Motion is carried. Now we can go on to the other options. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, Michael. One thing that I think that we all need to understand is that, you know, what right now we're in good times, we're doing this, and what Dave's bringing, is the point he's making is valid in that the operating cost versus the total cost. There may come a day, and at the rate the state's going, much sooner than any of us want to deal with it, where that number's gonna have to contract.
Seriously.
And that'll be beyond our control. And those luxuries, such as you know, these monies that we're moving over to maintenance or what have you, may not be available for a period of time. But I just wanna make sure that we throw that on the table here. And once we approve this budget, as far as the Board of Education is concerned, I believe the MBR is reset. Well, right now we're suspended, right?
Right.
But we're going to reset.
Well, that's another thing that's entirely up to the state. If they come back and put the MBR back in place, are they going to say to the year prior to the suspension, or are they going to say to the last year?
We don't know that.
We don't know that. And,
but
and
just to say,
we can't deal with unknowns.
Doomsday scenario is that they adopt what we have here as the new MBR. Then when cuts need to be made next year to make up for some of these monies, as you correctly pointed out, Mr. Richardson, the cuts are going to probably mostly come out of the Board of Selectmen's budget. We need to be aware of that. I just voted in favor of this motion. I'm just making sure that this hits the table so we all understand that. We won't be able to go back next year and cut beyond whatever the state allows us for decreasing enrollment, which is what now, 6,000 ahead?
I believe that's the number.
Right. So any funding that we have to make up next year, backfill, may not be available from some of the sources we're looking at this year. So I just want to make sure that, that everybody understands that in the room.
Just to correct one thing, it's the MBR hasn't been suspended. The MBR was lowered by the cut in the ECS funding.
Okay.
So in effect, for us this year, the MBR is $15,900,000 or somewhere in that ballpark. So the state doesn't have to actually do anything. The MBR ends up, it's never been suspended, it was just reduced by the reduction in ECS funding.
But we don't know where that's going next year.
Right.
We don't even know what's going, we don't know what's going.
Exactly, exactly.
Right, so we get.
We have to, I just want to make sure everybody understands that, you know, if we're gonna make up a half a million dollar shortfall next year, it probably can't come out of the Board of Ed budget. Next year. 18-19.
Well, the.
Just saying it out loud, that's all.
Yeah, the, they're probably gonna see a, about a 30 student reduction next year. So you're looking at about $180,000.
Yeah, $6,000 ahead.
Yeah.
That's
it.
So I just wanted to make sure we said that before we moved on to item two of our discussion. All right. So with that said, based on those numbers, now we need to look at our funding options. And I am of the opinion that going forward at this time, we shouldn't be taking monies out of our general fund when the impact is only going to be 0.28 mils because that would take it away from us in the future. Anything that we do take from that will no longer be there. So I would support going forward with a slight mil increase to absorb that difference rather than drawing money from the general fund. That would be a fallback mechanism if the worst case scenario were to come about. Anyone?
I would just point out that I agree with you, sort of. Except that you gotta realize what that means is for the average taxpayer, what they're gonna be voting on at that referendum is a 5.2% tax increase. I don't know that they've ever voted on a 5.2% tax increase, because I don't know, you know, maybe back in 2004 or 5 or something when things were going crazy. That's gonna be a big bite. Well, we just gotta realize it.
And that information has to be out there. Somebody has to get that information out there, and then the people have to make up their minds.
Yeah.
If they're willing to buy into that.
Yeah.
That's the way I look at it.
How do you get the 5%?
The state at 24.04 mils is a 4% tax increase. The real rate after the reevaluation is 23.1. And from past experience in town meetings and such, there are quite a few people who understand that, because they asked that question on a reeval. What's the adjusted mill rate? The adjusted mill rate would be 23.1. So 24.04 is a 4% tax increase. Add 0.28 to it, which is another 1.2%, and you're up to a 5.2% tax.
Right, but we go back to what I was saying earlier, that the 4% based on the revaluation is not necessarily a tax increase. It's based on the revaluation of property. The effect.
Tell that to the guy who gets the tax.
I got you. I'm there. But the effect, I understand the effect is that somebody's going to get a tax increase. Some people are going to get no tax increase. Some are going to get 15%. It's an effective increase, but it's not an increase in the percentage of growth in the government budget, that level of tax increase.
It's a four for the average taxpayer. It's a 4% tax increase. And I don't know the median would be, but if it's a relatively normal distribution of stuff, it's going to be about half the people are going to see 4%. The other half are going to see something less than 4%. And probably about 65% of the people are going to see more than a 3%.
Yeah, there's a couple of different ways we look at it. It's also 1%, 1.16% mill increase. I mean, there's a lot of different ways.
The way people are going to look at it is, my bill was X.
Yep.
Now it's Y.
I hear you.
What's that? They don't care at all. And I'm telling you that if you just look at the numbers, about 65% of the people will see at least 3%. 50% will see 4%. Some folks are going to, if they haven't figured it out yet, are really going to get their socks knocked off. But that's, you know, the assessment. That's just the way it is.
Sorry. I mean, you make a good point, but finally, the real estate market's improving throughout the entire country. And we happen to live in this little town where all of our tax revenues come from residential taxes. And I hope people are intelligent enough to understand that we just had a revalue, that their property values just went up. People evaluated it went up. And consequently, they have to pay more taxes. It's not that we've been spending 5% more of their money. It's because they live in a town that property taxes went up and property values went up. I think people understand that.
Fortunately, the increase helped cover the $1,050,000 decrease,
right,
in state grant revenue.
Yes, absolutely.
That's the thing we got going. It just happens to be coincidentally on our side this year.
Absolutely. And actually, it's that plus the $400,000 there. Pay it this year that they didn't have to pay. Don't forget that.
Right.
There's a $393,000
over under number.
Yep.
Chunk sitting out there that they paid in taxes this year that wasn't necessary. So now they're going to get to pay that plus the 600 and some odd thousand from the assessment. That's what makes up the $1 million. This $400,000 thing, unless with understated revenues again by a whole bunch, isn't going to show up again next year.
And that's why I made my disclaimer before we started this conversation. That's why I brought that up. But right now, this year, what we're talking about is we're talking about a 1%, you know, 1.1% mill increase over last year. The effect of that is the 4% you speak of, and the percentage of the 0.28 mills.
And it's 5.2.
That would be the effect if everybody was equal.
If you're getting the tax bill, and let's say your bill was $10,000, it's going to go up by $520.
And I hear
that's
you.
Just
that's
the way
what,
it is.
Well, that's what the referendum's about.
Yeah.
And to tell me.
Exactly. I'm just want to make sure everybody's thinking about it. 5.2% is a big number. It's not a number that I recall in the last 6 or 7 years.
No.
8 years.
You know, and Dave, I don't want to. We're better for you bringing these points up.
They're not always popular.
I thank you for bringing them up. You know, you do a whole lot of work. And sometimes we agree, sometimes we agree to disagree. But I don't want to dispel what you're trying to say. I'm just trying to make my point of the effect. There's an effective increase based on the average. There's a mill rate increase. That's a hard number. My own personal property taxes, I don't want to tell anybody, is an 8% increase in my valuation, plus this. Am I going to enjoy paying that? Not a bit. But I'm willing to do it. It's, you know, I added the value to my property. I'm going to take advantage of that if I ever sell the property. It really needs to be, you know, it needs to be here. And then what we're talking about tonight is over here.
We're just trying to justify it to ourselves. And all I'm trying to say is 5.2%. Be aware of that, because when we get to that referendum, and they're voting on a 5.2% tax increase, what's the chances that they approve that? Beats me. We'll find out when it happens. If everything goes, if we have to eat $863,000, I don't think we can eat that in the general fund.
No.
That's too big a nut. If we ate, that's what I passed out, if we ate $500,000 of it, you can understand what the impact is.
Right.
And now, instead of talking about a 5.2% tax increase, what are we talking about? We're talking about 7.5% increase. That's got even more problems going forward. And I'm just elephant with Chuck. And there's a couple of things in between. And that's all we're really talking about. And we can't go much further than that because we don't know what we're talking about.
Sure.
We have no idea.
Anyone else? Yep.
I'm not sure quite what topic we're on. Which issue we're actually discussing?
Well, right now we're discussing how in fact we're going to pay for it.
At this point, I would be in favor of just raising the mill rate. Maybe tell me if I should stop talking about this, but it's my understanding that the state legislature has been kicking around a 5% or 10% option for the teacher pension. Is that something? And maybe if I'm talking about this at the wrong time, let me know and I'll stop. If we're just talking about saving the mill rate, I'll stop. If we're talking about other things,
That's kind of what we're looking to get out of the way right now is whether we in fact increase the mill rate or take money from.
As the budget stands, I would not be, the teacher pension aside, I would not be in favor of dipping into the general fund.
0.28, I'm comfortable with the mill increase.
Fred?
Yeah.
Same. Dave?
Are you saying that if the teacher's pension comes in at 860?
No.
Forget that.
We already had a motion about the mill rate.
No, we did not.
All we discussed was the number.
It's uncomfortable.
But what, 2.8? Right now, we're looking at is everybody in agreement that it should come out of a tax increase?
Yes.
Versus out of the general fund?
Yeah, I agree.
Okay. All right.
Do you want to do that as a motion?
We could.
Well, we need to do that.
I don't think it needs to be done as a motion. Okay. It's just that.
Right. As long as it's in the minutes.
Yeah.
It's just a lot of the stuff is just way premature. There's so much stuff we don't know.
That's correct.
We're trying to gain as a consensus of opinion here going into the public hearing.
Exactly.
From the board.
Yeah, no, I understand it, but I think what you really got to understand is elephant with Chuck.
I think we understand that.
That's about all you can figure out at this point.
I think we got that.
But we don't know which one of those is going to show up at our door.
That's right.
And when the time comes,
big trouble.
And when the time comes, we need to be prepared.
So I guess my question is now, let's move it on to the second item. I shouldn't say that, because I don't know what you meant by funding options. But talking about the teacher's pension issue, it would be, my opinion is that we should take no more, or we should fund it with up to, but no greater than $500,000 out of the general fund, depending on what we finally get with the number.
Well, if we do that, that would be above and beyond Prop 46.
Would it?
No, it's not material. Prop 46.
That's, I don't think it is.
But
it's a backfill of funds, I think.
Well, maybe I'm misunderstanding, because you're talking about the teacher pension.
Only the teacher's pension.
Okay, so if the bill comes in at $500,000.
No.
He's saying
863, that only $500,000 would be funded by
the general fund.
We'd have to make up the balance.
So the balance would be coming out of either the town budget or the Board of Ed budget, is what you're saying.
That's correct. Which we'd have to determine a ratio, or if that's what we want to do, or, you know, we wouldn't be taking enough out of the general fund, or we're taking too much. I'm just giving you my opinion. My opinion is I wouldn't want to take more than $500,000 out of there. And that, I believe, I'm sure Karen can straighten me out on this later, but I think that would reduce us to from 15.28 to about 12.8% uncommitted general fund balance.
As which would fall between
this budget.
Yeah, which would fall between the 8 and 15% that
right.
We said.
Right, drop us right to the middle between the 8
and 15. Off the top of your head, what is the fund balance right now?
I have
3.4 million.
Yeah, 3,416,477, I believe. That would bring us to 2,916,477, which would be 12.8% of our proposed budget that we just talked about a minute ago. So we'd still be in good shape financially. Of course, this is my numbers. I'm sure Karen works them over. I'm pretty confident they're correct, but.
So I guess, I'm just trying to understand what you're saying. If the total budget right now is roughly 22.6 million, 22.67 million.
Yep.
You're saying that instead of paying, if the bill came in at 500,000 or if the
863,000.
If the bill comes in at the original proposal,
yeah,
we would cover 500,000 of that.
Out of the general fund.
But the,
and this budget would not go up. Can't go up.
Right, yeah, well, we can't exceed this budget.
Right.
Well, I get.
Look at it a different way.
I got it.
Instead of looking at it like, is the bill you're going to pay, think of it as less revenue that you're going to get. And that makes it a whole lot easier. I mean, right now we're talking about 22,480,000. If for some reason the 683 didn't show up, we would have $683,000 less to work with, and that would have to be made up. It's just a little bit easier, because it's not really, it's a bill, but it's not a bill. It just means you're not going to get the money.
That's correct.
And, you know, if you think about it that way, it's a little bit easier.
Right, so it's a reduction in, but what I'm just trying to clarify, Dave, if I may finish my question. The total allowable budget is 22.67 million.
Yep.
And if we are reduced by whatever the teacher's pension bill non-payment that applies to that, we would have to make that up out of the town budget and the Board of Ed budget, no matter how we cover.
No, you could cover it with a tax increase.
Tax increase.
You could increase the taxes by the difference.
With a supplemental bill.
You could do it. If you know about it ahead of time.
Ahead of time, you could do it.
You could do it.
Otherwise, you would have to do a supplemental tax bill.
No, but we would still be reducing the Board of Ed in the town budget, no?
No.
They would remain the same. The difference would be, basically what you're looking at is the state is going to send us so much in grants, mm-hmm. We're going to turn around and send them back $863,000 of that. So it's a reduction of revenue on the balance sheet.
Okay.
So we have to make up that reduction of revenue.
Gotcha.
So we take now what we did get in funds.
Okay.
Minus that from the budget, and the difference has to be made up either from the general fund or through increased taxes.
So you're talking about it's the 863, if it's the total amount. 863, we take 500,000 out of general fund and make up the 363 out of the
between the town
and the supplemental tax bill?
Or, yeah.
Basically, I guess what I'm saying is take no more than 500,000 out of the general fund. And then we'd have to decide how we want to make up the 363,000.
So the 363 would be made up by a tax bill. So if you know early, well,
okay, we could add it.
Let me finish. If you know early, you'd build it into the rate.
Correct.
If you know after July or after June 30th, which is a probable scenario, then it would have to be a
supplemental tax bill.
So it's taxes, whether it's
okay.
Or, in the regular bill or it comes after.
Or it comes
just
out
think of
it
as a tax increase.
Or it comes out of their budgets. Or, yes, if you didn't want to go with a supplemental tax increase, it would come out of their budgets. And my thought would be, if
around the budgets, it should be at the same rate that we split the budget. So that would be 78%, 22%.
We're so.
I'm just trying to propose a scenario for everybody to think about. We don't have to necessarily decide on all that tonight. I'm just saying, no more than 500,000. If we don't go for a tax increase to cover the balance, we take it out of the two budgets at 78, 22% wise.
Okay, I do have a point is that taking out of the budget is off the table after the referendum.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. Well, it is when it comes to the Board of Ed, because once we approve a budget for the Board of Education, that becomes their budget, and by state statute, it's hands off for us.
Okay. So our only options at that point is to cut it from the Board of Selectmen's budget or a percentage of it and make the rest up in another tax increase.
It's an and or.
Yeah. Have you heard, what I've heard is that they're tossing around either a 5 or 10% payment rather than the 30. So
I just want to plan.
Right, no, I understand.
And hope to do better than that.
Yeah.
All those decisions we can make at that time.
At that time, correct. Okay. Yeah.
We should have a
plan somewhere down the road where we're going, so that we don't start this whole process
from scratch.
From scratch, yeah.
Yeah. So I guess what I'm looking for is that the group think that 500,000 maximum withdrawal from the general fund uncommitted balance is reasonable and agreeable with everybody, and then we'll have to figure out how to make up the rest.
I would buy that as a limit.
That's what I'm looking at right now.
I think it's a good place to start, but I wouldn't want to form any opinions as a board without hearing more public input.
Yeah, that's still going to have to be voted on anyway. So,
yeah. And remember, the public can tell us to take the entire amount, but at some point, our policies, our fiscal policies, say we can't go below.
Right. No, I understand that.
And to speak to some of the stuff that Dave is talking about, the following year, that won't be available.
Right, right.
That money's spent.
That's gone.
So now you're looking at some really serious cuts. So I just want to put it all on the table. That kind of came up with $500,000. We originally, I think Dave was going to suggest $700,000 originally. I'm saying less.
The $700,000 was when it was just $700,000. We not only have to make up the $500,000 that we would take, we have to make up the $393,000 in the over-under. So that means we would go into next year $900,000 in the hole. That's to be at zero. And then we go from there. So it's kind of like a hidden thing here, because you're making this decision based on what you're going to do this year. But you got to remember, what you do this year
is going to affect what you can do next year.
Well, if I'm understanding correctly, that would be saying, let's cut some this year so we don't have to cut as much next year, and the end result would be the same?
It's hard to...
Exactly.
That's why you can only go by what you currently know.
Right.
And again, you have to pray for the best case scenario, and if the worst happens, then we have to deal with it.
But by setting a limit of how much we'd be willing to take out of the general fund,
I think it's important to have that consensus.
Yeah, to help us make decisions. Again, we can spread this contraction, if you will, over a couple of years rather than really go crazy and take a huge amount out this year. We could change all this. But it's just so that everybody understands and has some kind of guidance in what we're thinking. That's what we're here to talk about tonight. That's what my feeling was. No more than $500,000, it would be up to the first $500,000 of that teacher's pension we could pay out of the general fund. Goes above that, then we start splitting it, what my own opinion is today. Could change my mind. Today would be to split it 78-22, 70% to 22% to
between the two boards, if it was to go to a full amount.
The problem is, you're not going to know, as Fred pointed out, until it's too late. We're going to be way after the fact. The only place it can come out of, if it's going to come out of any place, would be the town budget. The school budget will have been set, the MBR will have been set. So it not only impacts this year, it impacts next year.
That's right. Perpetual.
And we make them up better on the ECS grant, and because that's the governor's proposal, without, legislature doesn't have to change the amount, how much they're giving out. He's proposing to change the distribution formula. The legislature doesn't agree with that distribution formula, we may come out better on that side.
Right.
It's all such a
speculation.
Yeah, it's like,
it's a very tangled
web. Walking in a blind, you know, while we're in blindfold, and looking at those animals, that he's got coming up to my
door. Just going to
That would make it even worse. So, I mean, and we did the worst case on the education side. So we may come up, I mean, there's a possibility we may come up better there at the end of the day.
We can only hope.
We can only hope that, you know, without the state having to spend more education money, just don't agree with the governor's redistribution plan.
So at this time, does the board feel you don't want to set a limit to what we'd be willing to take out of the general fund?
Not on record. I just
Well, I'm not talking about my motion. I just want to make sure that we all
from a practical standpoint, you can't go much higher.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Because then next year becomes totally untenable.
Right.
So that's kind of the upper limit, and you go.
I don't see we need to take a vote on it. We just have discussion about it. So like you said, we've got some
stuff to think about.
Think about some plans, trying to get place, but I don't want to go on record on it.
Yeah, I just don't want to, you know, to begin the thinking process after the public hearing and take 20 minutes to try to figure this out. We need to be thinking about this well ahead of time so that we can have an informed discussion.
Actually, there's nothing that's going to change between now and the 18th of April. What we're talking about is if there's a point where this is going to come to a head, it's going to be the night of the referendum. If the referendum passes, and we got to set a mill rate, that's when the whole issue is going to come. And we got to know. So that's middle of May. We're probably going to be just as blind, Fred. So,
too busy thinking about the ceiling.
Yeah.
We're doing useful.
Anything else? Anyone? No. All right. I guess we go on to correspondence and announcements. You got the only correspondence that I have received, which is the letter from the attorney. And as far as announcements goes, next Tuesday night, April 4th, will be the public hearing, 7 p.m. here. The 18th will be the night in which we set the final budget and appoint the auditor. The annual town meeting is scheduled for the 9th of May, and the referendum is scheduled for the 16th of May. If there's nothing else, we'll take a motion to adjourn.
I kind of hate to say this, but at this point, but following this letter, following this logic, what if next year a tornado comes through and wipes out the fire department and we have severe expenses? We can't deal with that.
Hopefully we have some insurance and cover.
Yeah, I was going to say, geez, I would hope so.
So there's nothing that, I mean, it's just...
The way Prop 46 is written right now,
that's... doesn't even make sense.
The way it's written right now, and that's the considered legal opinion year after year. And I have my disagreements with it as well. And
it's irrelevant, actually.
It makes no difference right now.
It's irrelevant.
It's not. I say something. When it comes to the the fire departments, and I heard at the last meeting, they talked about the fire department. We never had any trouble until the state came in and started all these restrictions that we have now. And that's going to be the problem with the volunteer fire departments. The state is going to eliminate all of the volunteer fire departments. That's what they're up to. So just to let you know, that's what the story is. Otherwise, you wouldn't have any trouble with firemen in your fire departments. You'd have plenty of volunteers if it wasn't for the state coming in with all these restrictions.
Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second. We have a motion. We have a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all. Thank you all for...